the weirdest things about just being alive is that in order to just survive, humans need to spend about a quarter of our lives unconscious and hallucinating. And one of the weirdest things about our total scientific knowledge is that we don't really know why we do a thing that we all do 8 hours every day. It's insane. It's like you'd hope that if humans spent 8 hours a day, every human on Earth spent 8 hours a day singing ABBA, even though a significant portion of the population didn't even want to, you would hope that we would have a pretty good idea of why. But sleep and dreaming remain this weird mystery that scientists are still slowly trying to figure out by coming at it from many different angles. For instance, why do we do it? What is actually happening in our brains when we do it? And how do we benefit from it, for instance? One of those angles is explored in a new study by Cardiff University researchers who are led by Professor Penny Lewis. And Lewis has a hypothesis about dreaming and how it can lead us to creative problem solving. I was intrigued by this research not only because I think sleep and dreaming are weird, wonderful things, but also because I think creative problem solving is a weird, wonderful thing as well. I remember when I first started working as a creative copywriter way back in the day, I was freelancing and super confused about how to bill my clients, because if I'm trying to come up with the perfect ad copy, I don't necessarily just sit down and write for, say, 2 hours and then bill the client for that. I first would read up on everything I needed to know, like what the product was, what the client wanted to say about it, who the customer is, whether it's a billboard or an email. And then I would take a break. I would go for a run or play a video game or something else that took my mind off of the work, because I found that when I would return to the problem, it would be way easier for me to just knock it out of the park compared to if I had just spent that time staring at an empty Word document. But I couldn't bill the client for the time I spent playing pinball, could I? I mean, even if that's when my brain was doing the heavy lifting in the background. The solution to that, I eventually realized, was to basically just bullshit like every other creative freelancer. You do your best to come up with a fair invoice and you don't stress about it too much. But I did notice that whatever creative solutions I could come up with after doing some unrelated activity paled in comparison to the solutions that came to me as I woke up the next day, if I ever had that much time to even work on a project. I wondered if other people had the same experience, and it turns out they do, and scientists like Professor Lewis are working on why. Prior to this research, there was scientific debate as to whether creativity is boosted during REM or non-REM stages of sleep. Lewis's hypothesis is that it's both of those things working together. She says that during our non-REM sleep, our brains replay our memories and overlaps them with other memories that share common characteristics. For instance, you might remember visiting an amusement park during that day. And also, you might remember visiting an amusement park from a few years ago and also as a child. And your brain focuses on the commonalities between those memories, a roller coaster, an overpriced hot dog, a log flume. That forms your idea of what an amusement park is in general. And then your brain enters the REM stage, in which it replays memories that might have an unexpected, novel association with those other things. So maybe swinging a bucket of water upside down connects to the loop-de-loop roller coaster in the way that things seem to stick to the bottom if it's moving fast enough while going upside down. Or maybe the log flume connects to, I don't know, I haven't taken a nap, so I can't come up with anything creative to connect that to. But your brain is basically cycling through a bunch of memories to see what sticks, forming connections between things that weren't necessarily connected before. And after about 90 minutes of all of this, it starts over again with the non-REM sleep. Lewis acknowledges some problems with this hypothesis. For instance, she thinks as part of this that the hippocampus, which is the area of the brain that records long-term memories of events, kind of pushes the neocortex, which is the part of the brain that records facts and ideas, into layering those common memories during non-REM sleep. She doesn't have the hard evidence to back that up. So she doesn't know for sure that that's what's happening, but she hopes to find that evidence in future studies. She also points to cases like a man who, due to a brain injury, can't experience the normal amount of REM sleep each night, but he still manages to be very creative, even to the point that he makes puzzles for his local newspaper. So it's all still kind of messy, but I'm excited to see what she does next. She's actually working with a computational neuroscientist to create an artificial intelligence that actually sleeps, so they can see what it's doing as it sleeps. How cool is that? And yes, I do desperately want to make an electric sheep joke here, but I can't, sadly, because my friend Ed Yong already beat me to that in an excellent article he wrote about this stuff in The Atlantic. You can find the link below on my Patreon. Please go read it, learn more about this super weird research, and maybe think about it before you go to sleep, and maybe in the morning you'll have come up with something that might help the researchers out. Who knows?